So first, what I'm going to share is from my experience, and remember that not all infidelity is created equal. In my particular situation, my now ex-husband cheated for years, from what I can tell, committed bigamy, and there were all kinds of layers to the betrayals of manipulation, financial, all this other stuff. So keep that in mind as I go through this. So first, before I had ever been cheated on, I would have expected three things to really be the most painful. The first of those is the physical affair. I thought that piece of it really would have been the most painful. Then I also expected that I would be, really felt betrayed and have a lot of anger and pain around the affair partner. And then finally, I expected that the last part would be trusting the person that cheated on me again, assuming that that was even an option. But what I found, what the reality of it was quite different than that. And that's not saying that those three things, well, actually, I never had a chance to even do the third, but the first two things, it's not saying that those weren't painful. Absolutely, the reconciling what happened physically definitely was painful. And oh, I spent many months fixated on the affair partner that I knew of and all of that. But surprisingly, those weren't the most painful elements of being cheated on. So, what did hurt the most then? Well, the first of those, and probably the biggest because it encompasses so much, were the years of lies and manipulations that he used to cover up what he was doing and to get away with what he was doing. In some ways, what he actually did hurt less than what he did to get away with it. And one of the reasons that that was so painful is because of what it does to your memories. Because as you learn the truth about different situations and different times, you then have the reality, that truth that you just learned, colliding with the memories that you have of what you thought was happening at that time. And that collision is so catastrophically painful. And it doesn't just happen once, because those memories continue to come up and those truths continue to kind of dribble in. And so those collisions happen again and again and again, every time taking you back to how you felt when you first learned about the affair. And then related to that was how deliberate it was, the intentionality of it, and how it wasn't just like a mistake, how this was a choice, a very deliberate choice made again and again and again. And the thought of somebody that supposedly loves you doing that to you over and over and over again, continually choosing their own selfish interests over your well-being over and over and over again is so hard to come to terms with. Another extremely painful part for me was the complete powerlessness that I felt. Before I discovered this, I felt like, well, I was the one driving my life. I was making decisions. I knew what I was doing. I had goals, I had plans, all of these things. And then I came to find out that, well, all of that was based on a lie. It was all a facade. And so those goals that I thought I had, yeah, just kidding. The plans that I was making, nope, forget that. And then to can add to all of that was the powerlessness in how he handled it during the affairs and after the affairs. I was never given a choice to even talk to him, much less, an attempt to reconcile. And so in all of this, he was the one that was like that puppet master pulling the strings. And I had no control over any of that. I never anticipated how unmoored, it's the only word I can think of, that I would feel after betrayal. It's this this really isolating feeling where you feel completely alone and you feel completely disoriented and confused and like you don't have anything that anchors you in your life anymore because everything has been called into question. And that's such a difficult place to be. I also never would have expected the weird shame that I would feel. I almost like blamed myself. I blamed myself for not knowing. You know, there was lots of internal dialogue of how could you be so stupid, so foolish? How did you not know? And then I blamed myself for not being the wife that, you know, he wanted or whatever. And all of that is utter garbage. But in that moment, I completely felt that way. And I never, ever expected that I would take on some of that. Another element that was so painful is that constant question, because you'll never know what was real and what was a lie. You know, when you think back to all of those times that they professed their love and all of those, you know, wonderful moments, were they real? Were they not? And we never really will get that answer. We each individually have to sort of arrive at whatever our own truth is on that. And I never recognized that before it happened to me of how painful that never-ending question can be. So often cheaters also engage in what I like to call character assassination, where they are saying horrible and usually untrue things about us to other people. They're basically painting us out to be the bad guy, often before they even begin to cheat, and then definitely during and then after the affair. And I never even thought that this could happen. I'd never heard of it. I wasn't aware of it at all. And so I was completely shocked just days after he left me when I started to hear from mutual friends about some of the things that he had said, the stories that he had been telling. And so it was painful on multiple levels because one, it was like just one more layer of, you know, the deception and manipulations that he was doing. And then it was accepting as much as I could that these people that I cared about, that I thought cared about me, had all of these misconceptions about me and had been believing this stuff for months, maybe even years. And then finally, that pain of having to make the decision to let those relationships go because you can't fight, you know, what somebody's been saying about you for quite some time, especially when they're skilled liars. Another thing that I never anticipated was how many dates, locations, rituals, events would become tainted for me. You know, our restaurant, which was one that I happened to love and was just down the street, well, all of a sudden it became this place that had so many memories. It was just so heavy. You know, going to the grocery store, I'll never forget one time, only a few weeks out, I walked by the display that had his favorite sparkling water, and I literally collapsed onto the floor because that stupid puddle of sparkling water somehow symbolized like an entire 16-year relationship. And that can be such a difficult thing because these are locations and experiences and dates that had such meaning to you. And now, well, they still have meaning, but now it's just like this lump in your throat every time you think about it or every time you approach. And this next one isn't quite so much pain as just a feeling I never expected to have. And that is that crazy feeling. There's no other word for it. That crazy energy around the obsessiveness that most of us get when it comes to the details around the infidelities. We fixate on it. We think that somehow if we know all of the things, or if we just find out this one thing, it'll somehow unlock the answers to everything. And it doesn't work that way. We're never going to get any peace that way. But that obsessive energy is, oh, I don't even know how to describe it if you haven't experienced it. But it is such an uncomfortable place to be because on the one hand, you know that you're acting sort of irrationally, but yet you can't get off that train. So before I was cheated on, I could anticipate that it would be extremely difficult to forgive the person that cheated on you. What I didn't understand, though, was how hard it is to learn how to trust yourself again. And that's true regardless of if you're still in that relationship or not. But you have to learn how to trust your own perceptions, your own intuition. And that is so difficult after you've been through something like this, especially if you've experienced manipulation and gaslighting along with it. And I also never anticipated the judgment that I would face from others. I'm almost speechless when I think back to some of the things that were said to me. Here my husband he was a criminal. He committed criminal acts. And yet I had people blaming me for what had happened. And then I had other people come at me with I don't believe in divorce. And so you're doing the wrong thing by divorcing him. And it was like, I don't have a choice. What else am I supposed to do in the situation that I am in? And we all face so much judgment when we've been through this. And I think that can be one of the harder things because we're looking for support. We so desperately want support. And so when people that we think would have our best interests at heart instead come at us with blame and judgment, it can be so difficult to sort of parse through all of that. And then finally, the last painful aspect that I didn't expect was how hard it is to go through your days pretending that everything is okay, even when your world is collapsing. Now, I don't have children, so I only had to do that around certain professionals, around certain friends, and then predominantly at work. For those of you that are parents, my heart goes out to you. How hard is it to pretend like you're doing okay in front of your children when inside you're anything but? And I have the utmost respect for you. And that strength, that way that you're holding it together during the day only to fall apart when you collapse into your bed at night, your kids, they're going to benefit from that. They're going to see that strength. They're going to learn from that strength. So I know I didn't capture all of the unanticipated sources of pain after betrayal. Are there any that you experienced that you would like to add?